Biology program at the University of Montana started in the fall of 1936. It's housed in the College of Forestry and Conservation, but it's formally a joint program between forestry, the Division of Biological Sciences, and the Cooperative Wildlife Research Unit. We have students today from 37 different states, 8 different countries within our program, almost 400 students overall. I could not be more pleased with the way the program has grown. The faculty here are dedicated, they're hardworking, they're bright. We're able to attract them in part because of Montana. And many of them want to be part of something bigger because of these leaders that we've had in the program in the past, because they see something special here. Phil Wright taught at the University of Montana mammalogy, ornithology, I believe from 1939 until 1984. Phil got his PhD from the University of Wisconsin, and when he applied for the job here, Aldo Leopold, who was a faculty member at the University of Wisconsin, wrote him a letter of recommendation. When Dick Cutto was hired as the ornithologist, Phil took him out on a field trip to show him where Phil had taken his ornithology classes on field trips.
And I was putting my binoculars on what, for me, I think was the first time in my life I'd ever seen this bird, which I thought was a pine grosbeak, but wasn't sure, and I said, I don't know, I think it's, and then pow, kaboom. He had his shotgun out, he shot that bird, it fell right at our feet, and he picked it up and said, pine grosbeak.
That was back in the day when you know, if you saw something neat, you needed to be able to prove that that was actually there.
That bird is now in the museum, one of the specimens collected, and I guess it must have been 1977, the fall.
Phil began developing this museum in the late 1930s, early 1940s, and the collection now I think has a little over 30,000 specimens. We can actually use material from those particular specimens that might have been collected 100 years ago and extract DNA from those. So the museum collection is really quite valuable.
Wes Pengelly was on the faculty for many years.
He started work December 1st, 1954, and then in 63, he was hired as a permanent member of the faculty. Later on, he became vice president and president of the Wildlife Society.
Wes was also very well known for his criticism of Yellowstone National Park. He felt that carrying capacity was exceeded by the numbers of elk that were in Yellowstone back in the 70s and 80s. And so he was almost persona non grata in the park at that time. Wes taught a course called Careers in Wildlife. He would tell them at the beginning of the class, only two of you are going to end up being wildlife biologists. And yet anybody who came into his office and sat down and talked to him would always get an earful about all the joys and the pleasures and the things that you can really achieve if you set your mind to it. He was a really good mentor to our students. Bart O'Gara was the leader of the Cooperative Wildlife Research Unit at the University of Montana for many years.
Bart was another person like Phil Wright, who was very student-oriented, very much a mentor to get students involved in research.
When I first came into the profession, emphasis were very heavy on enhancement of game populations for fishermen and for hunters. I think it's been one for moving from a rather narrow game-oriented profession to one that's looking more at the total ecosystem.
Dick Tabor was on the faculty back in the 1960s, and he actually got his master's degree working with Aldo Leopold at the University of Wisconsin.
When I was up there trapping running in Alaska, I got a wire that said, would you teach 6 courses in wildlife at the University of Montana? The University of Montana has a very good establishment of colleagues in zoology and botany, very competent people. So the University of Montana was a good place to teach wildlife.
And later, when Dick was in his late 80s, he won the Aldo Leopold Award from the Wildlife Society for his many contributions on wildlife research in the northwestern part of the United States. John Craighead was the leader of the Montana Cooperative Wildlife Research Unit, spent about 25 years at the University of Montana, widely known around the country and around the world for his research on grizzly bears in Yellowstone Park.
I got a call from E.L. Cheatham asking me if I'd be interested in a job over here. I liked what I saw, and I said I would accept the job. And I came as the leader of the Montana Cooperative Wildlife Research Unit. There was hardly a weekend that we weren't at meetings to help get the Wilderness Act passed. I got very much involved in the Wild and Scenic Rivers Act. And then in just the basic management of species now that we don't think much about. And my brother and I developed the technique of radio tracking of large mammals. And we developed it in our study of grizzly bears in Yellowstone. I learned a great deal because I was pretty naive. The managing of wildlife resources is much a political task, but it is a biological one, and the politics usually override the biological. I began my career here, and I stayed here, even though I had many other opportunities, simply because I loved the country and because I got into long-term work to carry on some of these studies long enough to get results that could be applied practically to the environment.
One of the things that we did 6 or 8 years ago was to raise the money for an endowed chair in John's name. And if there's one thing I'm proud about, it's being able to get that done and introduce the whole idea and the concept to John at a reception a number of years ago and have John there to receive that honor. He's somebody who had a huge impact on many, many lives, especially of graduate students at the University of Montana.
So the Craighead Chair comes with trying to follow on the tradition of what John J. Craighead did, and he brought to the university, and he brought to America, and he brought to the world innovative wildlife management, conservation, education, inspiring people.
We're very proud to have two endowed chairs here at the University of Montana, the John J. Craighead Chair and the Boone and Crockett Chair. The Boone and Crockett Club endowed a chair here back in the early 1990s. Hal Salwasser was the first Boone and Crockett professor, followed by Jack Ward Thomas, who had been chief of the Forest Service, and today it's Paul Krausman as chair.
A lot of my research interest is related to habitat. We're looking at habitat relationships between caribou and clearcuts and calving areas up in Newfoundland, and we're currently working on habitat studies with bison in central Montana. Their support of the Boone and Crockett Professor Program provides them with biological information that they can use to drive their policy initiatives in conservation.
Within the Boone and Crockett Program, my master's thesis focused on bison and cattle comparisons in the Northern Great Plains. We were looking at how do we manage a species of concern, in this case bison, and the presence of human influence. The Boone and Crockett program offers some unique opportunities that allow students like myself to study these questions that need to be answered right now.
And that research budget, that allows us to have the flexibility to bring in students to deal with studies that we think are important.
We are so pleased that people stood up and contributed to these efforts so that these sorts of senior level people who are really at the top of their game can participate on our faculty and continue that tradition of excellence that was started by people like Wes Pengelly, Bart O'Gara, Phil Wright, and so forth. The Wildlife Biology Program is now a little over 75 years old, and we have had a long string of absolutely amazing faculty members. Four of our faculty members have been Aldo Leopold winners, four have been presidents of the Wildlife Society. They've been very engaged with their students. Our graduates are off at places like the Smithsonian with the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service in Washington, D.C., but in all 50 states and many, many countries around the world. For global conservation to be successful, we have got to have people who are well-trained, who know how to work with people, but also who can work with wildlife to come up with solutions to the conservation issues today. And the issues that were around 30, 40, 50 years ago, some of them are the same that we have today. Others are different. Global climate change, that's going to take things in directions we're just starting to figure out today. Human population, 7 billion and growing. These sorts of issues are going to demand problem solvers in the future. We aim to produce those kinds of people here at the University of Montana.